I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I your grace is more, grace is found, is where you are. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me.
The Lord that came to me was this: you have to arise and shine. And I said, well, I've heard that before, Lord, somewhere. And yes, and I knew where it came from. It came from the very book of Isaiah, arise and shine. So that's what started me on this journey again. And I began to do a bit more research. And of course, if you've preached as long as I have, you know you've preached on it before at some point. You know, and so you do a bit of research and you look back and say, Lord, what's the message for today, though? What's the message for us today? And I noted something that I had quoted back in 2009. And this is what it said. It was a quote from a university graduate. And he said this: my sociology teacher told me that Christianity was responsible for the Inquisition, the Crusaders, and many other evils in the world. My biology teacher taught me that I was a product of natural process of evolution. My philosophy teacher taught me that there were many roads that lead to heaven and that it was my choice because I was the ultimate decider of truth. I came away believing that God was a crutch for the broken people. And since I wasn't broken, I didn't need him, even if he existed at all. Now, that was a quote that came out of a university student here in Brisbane back in 2009 or just prior to that, because I've got the quote. But then came the fallout from 9/11. Then came Iraq. Then came Afghanistan. Then came ISIS. Then came the money crisis. Then came COVID-19. Then came political instability and the rise of China. And so now, these very same people who considered themselves unbroken are now fearful. Life can change things very quickly. We can make these bold statements, but if they're not based on truth and on the Word of God, we can find ourselves with a mud on our faces, if you like. The Word of God came to us and said, I want you to arise. You see, we can't be apathetic in a world in crisis. It's not a time for Christians to withdraw. It's a time for Christians to stand up. Not in a radical kind of a sense, but to stand up for Jesus, to stand up and begin to and continue to share of the hope that you have in Jesus Christ. It's not a time for backing away. It's a time for moving forward. The word comes in Isaiah 60 and it says, arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord rises upon you. See, darkness covers the whole earth, and thick darkness is over the peoples. But the Lord rises upon you, and his glory appears over you. In Isaiah's time, it looked a bit like today as well. And the word of the Lord came to them and said, look, your light has come. He's speaking to people, the Jewish people, the Israelite people, who had the revelation of God. They knew about God. They had the commands of God. They were supposed to be leading the way in their world. And he says, it's time. The light has come. And when he talks about this light coming, he says, and this light is going to show shine in the darkness. He says, "This the Lord himself is going to rise and appear over you." And what that means is just simply this. People are going to see something. When the grace of God is upon you and when the grace of God is upon me, it can be seen. It can be seen. And so if we're going to arise, we've got to understand and get an understanding of this light. You see, the light may have come, they may have received the Ten Commandments, they may have received revelation that God was there, they may have seen the mountain shake and all that sort of thing, but there was a greater one that was to come, and of course, and that one is called Jesus. And Jesus spoke, and he got up on one occasion, and he said this, he said, I am the light of the world. And whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. The light has come in all its fullness. And we can't keep that light to ourselves. In fact, it's got to be shown. I notice in this passage that Jesus was speaking, and he talks about him being the light of the world, and he says, Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness. What a great promise that is. Whoever follows me. You know, it's more than just believing about something. I might, I can be sitting over here or standing over here, and if someone was to follow me and I was going over to Foodworks, I wouldn't just be sitting here watching them go. If I am following somebody, I would be accompanying that person to Foodworks. That's what following means. Yes, I know Foodworks is over there, but I'm following somebody. Jesus says, if you follow me, that means walking with him, walking beside him. It has that picture that comes into the equation. I'm walking with Jesus in this world. That word follow, it's a participating word that is being given. The other thing about light is, you notice that light gives a different perspective. You know, if you were to describe a culture, I wonder what you would describe, how you would describe it. Just say with one word, how you would describe the USA. I'll give you a clue. They've got a big statue outside of a major city. And what's it representing? It's freedom. Out of all the different things that you can think about in relation to the USA, the common thing that comes to people's attention is freedom. Now, if we were to ask about Australia, I thought about this and I thought, what is the culture of Australia? So I had to do some research because I couldn't think of something straight off. What is it? And this is what the researchers have come up with. They said, with the people of the fair go, we believe that people need to have a fair go. I thought, well, yeah, that ticked my box. I thought, well, yeah, that's pretty cool. Basically, that's what it is. We've got a whole lot of flaws, but that's what it is. Well, in this culture, in this time that we're looking here, there's the ancient Greek culture. Some of you Bible students will know, what were the Greeks, what was their main focus in that era? What was it? Close. It was knowledge. They were into knowledge and trying to get as much knowledge as they could. And so in that era, that was what it was. For the Hebrew people or the Israelite people, they had another focus. And that focus was light. That's why I'm just giving you that background to help you to understand some of the scriptures that come out. It was light. And so Paul, when he's writing to the Corinthians, he says this. He says, for God who said, let the light shine out of darkness, is talking about creation there, you know, when God said, let there be light. He says, the same God who said that has made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. And what their understanding was is this. When God shines his light, that light is a metaphor. They're saying this. Everything that is good comes from God. And when God shines his light into me and into you, you know it's good. He always reveals the good. He always does and brings things that are valuable into my life. That's what light is. You know, it'll give you a different perspective on things. God's got a good a habit of doing that. You know, we heard a testimony or two yesterday talking with people how God changed their life. And one guy, it was Brendan, I think it was, he got up and he said this. He says, from a jailbird to now leading this group, he says, there was a change. There was a change that happened. He says, I can't even explain it all, but a change that happened in my life. You see, the light had come in. He had got a revelation of God. There was someone else I was talking to in the last couple of days. I forget who it was. I was talking to so many. But one of the things that was said is, he said, you know, Christianity is more than just believing. It's a knowing. It starts with the believing, but it gets to the point where I know. I know I'm part of the family of God. I know who I belong to. I know God is real. I know, gee, you see, there's the know that has to come into this equation as well. The thing that the Word of God talked about here in its context was this. He used this terminology in talking about the knowledge and the glory in the face of Christ. gazing into his face. You say, well, that's a strange thing to say. Well, what does that mean? And here's a tip. If you want to study the scripture, when you see something like that, read it in its context. See what's gone on beforehand. It'll give you the tip of what he's talking about. So you've got to understand, when the Bible was written, it didn't have chapters in it. So you're reading the Bible and it's got this chapter. That wasn't in the original. It's just one long letter. You see, so you've got to read the context of all of this to sometimes put it into place. And so before this, in talking about the face of Jesus, earlier Paul was commenting about Moses. And he said, do you remember Moses when he received the word and he encountered the Lord God? He came down out of that mountain and his face glowed. It glowed to such an extent that they had to put a veil over his face because the people couldn't look at him. You say, well, that's pretty cool. Does that happen today? I don't know if anyone knows, but if you want to read Arthur Blessed's testimony, he's a guy that tramps right around the world carrying a cross to try to talk to people about Jesus. But in his book I read, he said on one occasion he had such an encounter with the Lord God, and he says, and I didn't know about it. He says, but it was a supernatural encounter. And he says, and I came home to my wife and I came in the door and she screamed. And he said, I've never had that reaction before. What's wrong? He says, your face was glowing. You see, it happens. It's maybe it's an exceptional thing, but it does happen. And it's happened more than just Moses. And so what we see here is that he begins to talk about the face of Jesus. You see, the problem with Moses was that the glow faded. He only had to put the veil on for a while because the glow faded. It wasn't there all the time. He says, but when you come to Jesus, when you look at Jesus, when you seek to follow his face, guess what? His face doesn't fade. It doesn't fade. Now, that's why the Word of God says this in Corinthians. Now, listen to this. But whenever you turn to the Lord, the veil is taken away. And we, with unveiled faces, all reflect the Lord's glory. You can't reflect something that you're not, you know, you've got to be looking at something to get the reflection back. You see what I mean? As you face Jesus, as you look at Jesus, the Word of God is saying to us, we will reflect the Lord's glory. And you say, well, I'm not perfect yet. That's all right. The Word of God says this. And you're being transformed into his likeness with ever increasing glory, which comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. So my problem, I just got to keep looking at Jesus. I keep looking at him. And as I keep doing that, his glory is reflected back. His glory is seen in me and it is seen in you. And the beauty is, and the Lord says, well, you're reflecting a bit of me already, but there's more to come. There's more glory to come. There's more of a greater reflection of the Lord Jesus Christ to come as I focus onto him. The key is the focus. The key is who I'm looking at. See, last week we said, your authority comes from who you serve. Today, it is, who are you looking at? You reflect who you're following. You will reflect who your focus is on. And so we see these things happening. And so Jesus says to us as his people to let your light shine. He said this in Matthew. He says, now he says, you are the light of the world, and a city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people put a lamp and put it under a bowl, Instead, they put it on a stand so it can give light to everyone. What are those key words in that verse? You. You are the light. Jesus says, I'm the light. Okay. He puts his light into my heart so it can reflect out to other people. You are the light. And you're not supposed to be hiding it. Okay. You are the light. Don't hide what you have. If we can just challenge each other and encourage each other, be ready to share of the hope that you have in Jesus Christ. Ask the Lord, Lord, who can you have? You give me an opportunity to share something today. What opportunity will I have when I go shopping? What opportunity do I have when I go to the workplace? What opportunity do I have? You don't have to force it down people's throat. Lord, you just open the door. You'll be amazed how many doors will get open. My problem is he opens more doors and I'm not quick enough. Oh, there's another door. I missed that one. I see one or two a bit like me. Another one in a minute. But you know what? If we get that kind of sense, yeah, I'm talking to one of the rallies and they raise something. Whoa. See, if you're kind of ready for it, you're more likely to be able to speak at the appropriate time. So by God's grace, we will get better at doing that. Don't let your light shine. Don't let your light shine. Do let your light shine. let's erase that little bit. Oh, seriously. Someone sort of says, Pastor John, yeah, you're talking like that with the light and all that. That's cool. But what does that actually look like practically? It seems to be, you know, it's all out there, hairy, fairy, light. Lights flashing, you can have lights flashing all over the place. But what's the practical? How does that practically work out so that people can actually see something? Isaiah also gives some tips in relation to that. He says some things, and he uses this term about a yoke and all of that sort of thing. So we're going to read it for a minute. But I want you to think, you know, many times the Lord has come and he has rescued us. He has broken the power of Satan over your life. Now, when I read this passage of Scripture, I want you to get a picture into your mind, because there's a picture of a couple of oxen coming up and all that sort of thing. But I want you to get a picture in your mind that there's some oxen that are being driven and there's someone driving them. What has happened in the spiritual is that person that is driving them, his power has been broken. That's Satan's power over your life and over mine. He's been taken out of the equation. But there's still some stuff that's holding me back to the past. Now listen to what Isaiah says, because he tells us this is what it's going to look like. Firstly, he says this in verse 6. Talking in comparison to fasting, he says fasting is a great thing, but he says this is what I've chosen and it's even better. Chosen to loosen the chains of injustice, to untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free, and to break every yoke. And what you're going to see there, you can see a picture. That's the picture that he's kind of seeing in that particular day. You see, the yoke is that board or whatever that's across the shoulders of the animal. It holds the animal together with the one that leads, because in this thing there's usually one dominant one that kind of leads. Just think that into your head. It's one that leads. Quite often they'll put one that's been trained with one that hasn't been trained. And that one that is being trained, that's the one that gives the lead. Okay, so this holds the animal to the other one that leads. Okay, in the spiritual, In the spiritual, what you're looking at here now is this, that thing across your shoulders, it is the oppression that's coming against you. That is the oppression that comes against you. The thing that puts you down, that you can't seem to break free from. It's the thing that's on your shoulder. It's the weight that is upon you. Now, the Word of God tells us that, first of all, you've got to loosen the chain. You see the chain on there? You've got to get that chain out of the equation. That chain is representing your old life. It is representing perhaps injustice that has come your way. It is representing the pain of life and all its different ways. It is representing that. He's saying, now you've got to loosen that chain. Guess what? He says, Satan's power has been broken, so he no longer can drive me. But you've got to loosen the chain. He says, the Word says to us, you loosen the chain. You see, sometimes we just let the chain sit there. We've got this chain that's tugging us back to that old life and the pain of that and all the other stuff that is there. He says, no, you loosen the chain. You've been set free. It's time for you to loosen the chain. Then it says here, untie the cords. You'll notice that there's a cord on the beast to the right going around the horns. The other one doesn't have it because that's the one that's giving the lead, you see. And he says, no, you've got to cut the cords. You've got to cut the cord that's around that lead animal. You've got to cut the cord of that thing that you know keeps leading you astray, that keeps pulling you down. That's your responsibility. The Lord has already dealt and paid the price. He's already broken the power of the devil over your life, but you've got to cut the cord. You're going to keep it there? Keep going down that same track? Falling into that same temptation, not putting things into place, or are you going to cut the cord? That's what he's talking about. And then it says you're going to break the yoke. That's that big thing across, going across the shoulders. Isaiah uses another verse in one of the earlier chapters. And this is what it says. It says, in that day, their burden will be lifted from your shoulders. Hey, that's a good thing. Have that burden lifted. Burdens are lifted at Calvary. I think there's a song going on about that. Anyway, in that day, their burden will be lifted from your shoulders. Their yoke from your neck. That yoke will be broken. And in the NIV and some of the other translations, it says this, because you have grown so fat. And you say, what? They looked at that and said, what? What? Grown so, what's this about? Just hang in there. Hang in there. What it is talking about is that you've grown so full of God that you've broken the very thing that has been holding you down. That's what it's talking about. You see, the person that's driving the thing's been taken out of the picture. In your life, you might think, oh, the devil comes back to harass me or whatever. Many times, sometimes he will do that, but many times we're led by our own desires that haven't been quite renewed yet. We haven't let go on the cord. We haven't broken those chains completely. We've still got this tug back to the older things. No, my responsibility is to get that chain broken. Let it off the hook. I don't need to go back into there. I don't have to be reminded of my past because I have a future. Okay, so I keep pressing on. I keep pressing on. I'm not going to let those things lead me down into temptation. Those cords are going to be broken. I'm going to put my face towards Jesus Christ. I'm going to be a follower of him. I'm going to begin to reflect him. And the more that you are filled with the very Spirit of God, the more you're filled with the image of Jesus in front of you, guess what? You get so full that that very yoke that has been put upon your shoulders, you will see that broken off. because you'll become so fat and so full. You get that? I like to see an amen occasionally. Yeah, you get that? Hey, if there's a yoke on your shoulder, guess what? Get yourself filled with the Holy Spirit. Get yourself full of God, and you'll see that yoke crack. You'll see it crack. You'll see it crack. He's done his bit. God has done it all. We have to take responsibility. And this is a promise, as I end with this, that if we do that, out of Isaiah verses 8 and 9, it says this, then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and he will say, here am I. What a promise. What a promise. Father, we just come to you. I pray, oh God, that the words that have been spoken today has been a great service, Lord. We give you thanks for your presence and the words that have come. But Lord, every bit of truth from yourself, burn it into our hearts, we pray. In the mighty name of Jesus, we want to walk free. We let go of that, those chains. Lord, unhook the chain. It's unhooked. It is released. The past is not the way I live now. I'm cutting the cords. I'm untying the cords that lead me down the wrong paths of temptation. I cut those cords, and I choose today to follow you wholeheartedly. In Jesus' name, amen. There's a song that's being played, and if you've been a fair bit of prayer today, but the song will be played, and if you need more prayer, feel free to come forth and we can pray with you. But it's a great song. It's one that we will be learning in the future. So get some of the words into your heart, and then you'll know it soon.
No guilt, no shame, No sin, no stain is greater than the great I am. No fear, no grave, no other name is greater than the great I am. No guilt, no shame, no sin, no...
Come on, sing it out.
Fear no grave, no other name is greater than.
You are great.